Welcome to Real Life. I'm so glad you're choosing to join us on this Thursday.
Our Hard Questions team has a risque viewer question that you don't want to miss.
Ooh, and we have another miracle in American history for you, and the music trio Cana's voice is back. You don't want to miss a moment.
Real Life starts right now. This is Real Life. God loves you. Jesus died for you. The Holy Spirit, He empowers you. And the Bible is your and my guide to abundant life. I'm the host, Don Black, and my co-host for life.
That's right.
My lovely wife, Terry.
Hello. Welcome. Welcome on this special occasion. So many ways as you're joining us, we are celebrating our...
Yeah, it's hard to believe this. 26th. Anniversary.
Yes.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. I've got makeup on you.
We don't really kiss. It's an air kiss. 26 years she's been married to me. Now, this is an amazing thing. I said to her, why didn't I bring flowers? And she said, because I didn't remind you. How true it is. There's lots going on in the program. We're so thankful. You know, last season... When we were closing last season, I talked about Terry's garden. You remember what we just call around the house now, the incident. the incident of acid being poured on her garden.
That's right.
I don't want to go back into it. It brings up way too many bad memories.
Memories.
So we've got some pictures for you to see of the garden as it survived. Terry, you want to tell us what we're looking at?
You know, I had to replant and put some new soil in, and you can see that it's been thriving, and we water it regularly. Oh, those are my wildflowers. And so I'm doing okay. I don't know. I'm interested in hearing how some of you had a garden. Mine was sort of mediocre. I'm thinking about trying to do something different. Uh-huh. Need a revival in my garden, just like we're having our own revival time coming up.
Yeah, all next week, you want to tune in primetime television for our In God We Trust revival time. Mm-hmm. What our nation needs, what we need, is a revival, an old-fashioned Holy Ghost revival that spreads across this nation with signs and wonders in the power of His Holy Spirit. That's what we need. We need to be wakened, shaken, and then we need to stand up and we need to take back this nation. And that's going to start with a revival. So we're going to start on our network with Revival Time. It begins next Monday evening. You want to join with. We've got speakers coming from all over the country. It's going to be quite an experience. You don't want to miss any of it.
Right.
You know,
Great music. Always have to
great
say that.
Great teaching, great preaching, mm-hmm. great testimonies.
Great music.
Challenges. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's the kind of television that is interactive television. So we're glad that you'll be able to tune in. Tell your friends about it, too. We see Jesus everywhere. Mm-hmm. We see Him in the news. We see Him in the music. We have music on today. I see Jesus in our musicians. I see Him everywhere. And sometimes... when you look at the news headlines and you look at it just at the right angle, if you look at the right places, you see God in our headlines.
I'm Sydney Grant for God in the Headlines. Here's your top story. A paralyzed bride walked on her wedding day after praying to God for healing. Jackie Gontra suffered a spinal cord injury when she jumped into a pool 8 years ago. Doctors told her she would never walk again. But determined to walk down the aisle on her big day, she shared her recovery process on Facebook. Jackie wrote in a post she refused to let her circumstances dictate her certainty in Christ. Jackie told Cosmopolitan magazine God told her if she put in the effort, He would meet her there and heal her. When she walked down the aisle on her wedding, there wasn't a dry eye in the room. The beautiful bride also stood during the ceremony and danced at the reception. Jackie says she never would have dreamed this would be the way that she would share God's glory.
Well, we're in a Hard Question segments where pastors come together to tackle the tough issues of the day. Hey, guys, that was quite a story.
Yeah.
Really? I mean, the miraculous power of the Holy Spirit and her walking down that aisle.
Mm. Amen.
That would get everybody's attention.
That would take some faith to do on your wedding day.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Well, wedding days themselves is kind of sometimes. so glad that we have Dr. William Glaze with us from Bethany Baptist Church in Pittsburgh. Pastor Pete Giacalone from Rainbow Temple in McKeesport, Pennsylvania.
Amen.
Pastor Anthony Gilbert from Kingdom Restoration Center in Pittsburgh. And new, and hopefully not come back, hopefully come back soon, Dr. Chris Marshall from New Life Christian Ministries in Saxonburg, Pennsylvania. Beautiful place, Saxonburg.
It is. Beautiful place.
Hey, guys, let's jump right into the first question, our hard question for today. A viewer called in and said, listen, is it okay for a man and a woman who've been divorced to live together and not engage in sexual relations? And this is apparently an older couple, I guess. I don't know for sure, but you get the gist of it. Right. You know, can you be in a platonic relationship and live together as a woman and a man?
Well, you know, as I look at the Bible, you know, what they're actually doing is kind of playing house. Mm-hmm. And God says that, you know, when a man and a woman, and I won't assume that they have some kind of relationship, even though they might not be having sex, that they have some kind of relationship. Mm-hmm. And the fact is, they're acting like married people. Mm-hmm. And God says, if you're in that situation, in Hebrews 13:4, mm-hmm. he says marriage is honorable. And so, you know, they're, you know, playing out this scenario, but they're not honoring what God would have them to do.
You know, the Bible says, and I agree everything with Doc said, the Bible says our lives are being watched every day. And in Matthew, it says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your see. So we're being watched. And if I were a pastor, I would have we would sit down and talk. And the reason why we'd sit down and talk is because what they are portraying to the next generation,
right.
It's not right. It's wrong.
Gentlemen. Go ahead.
Okay, what I was going to say is, just to follow up with what Doc said, everything that we do is watched, but also everything that we do, according to Paul, it's permissible, but not everything is beneficial. Everything it says is permissible, not everything is constructive. Nobody should see his own good, but the good of others. Seek his own good, but the good of others. So this couple, if they come and play house, if they come and live together, and the question about divorce, I don't think it even matters.
Right.
Because the key question is, we're coming together, and I don't assume they're brother and sister here.
Yeah,
you know, right. I assume they're unrelated people, and they're coming together, and they're setting a very poor example. And my guess is, because I think all of us have probably been here, a couple wants to do this for financial reasons.
Mm-hmm. Right,
because
right.
They're older, it says. Mm-hmm. This probably has some kind of Social Security ramifications. Mm-hmm. But the thing that I would say to them is, seek God first. I mean, Matthew 6:33, Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything you need will be added to you. So do we want God to supply our needs, or do we want, you know, the government or somebody else to supply our needs?
Right.
The primary issue is the example we're setting, mm-hmm. and doing what's honorable, what's right, mm-hmm. before the Lord. And obviously, to live together, whether there's a sexual relationship or not, they're living as a husband and a wife.
Right.
That's right. Pastor.
Well, I have a little bit of a different twist on that, not taking away from it at all. And I agree totally with the fact that we need to be examples. But I also believe the key area of sin is the sexual piece. And so it's not just the fact that, because two people could live together, and if they're not having sex, is that considered a sin? Now, it may not look good, and I agree, it's not a good example. I don't agree that that's the best example to set. But at the same token, if they're two older people, but they're living in the same house and they're not having sex, that's the key issue, I believe. But if you are together, you're also opening the door to go down that path even quicker.
Yeah.
You know, if you're living in the same bed and things along that line.
Sometimes life circumstances and situations you have to find solutions. And maybe it is, in that regard, a man and a woman who need a solution, that they have to have some place left. If they had a third, if it was a three-bedroom apartment instead of a two-bedroom apartment or a one-bedroom apartment, it changes the dynamic of everything. Then it's not, the appearance of evil breaks up in that regard. So I would counsel them, well, hey, that's great. Find a third person to come in and get involved too. But let's shift to gifts for just a minute. A lot of young people today, a lot of young Christian people today are saying, you know, marriage isn't working out too well for everybody else. But I found somebody I love. You guys probably have counseled this.
Oh my.
And we're going to move in together.
Yeah.
You know, we're not going to get married yet. we want to get married someday. Right. We're going to get married. What do you say to that young couple?
Well, I would say two things. First of all, I would say, and this is clear, this is not even Christian organizations that are doing this. Statistics show that people who live together before they get married, mm-hmm. I mean, there's just so many negative things that happen, you know, once they get married. I mean, you know, just as far as marital satisfaction, you know, even in cases of abuse, and I mean, it's just a higher rate of some of these things. So, that's one thing. And then the other thing is that you're living together with no commitment. Mm-hmm. And so when there's no commitment, you know, I think that that takes away from the relationship.
And every time we go away from God's pattern, bad things happen. And marriage is designed into the fabric of creation.
That's right.
It isn't something that just came along in the Mosaic Law. It isn't something that Jesus, he did speak about it, but he didn't create the idea. God created marriage in the fabric of creation for the benefit of everybody. I mean, he wanted us to be fruitful and multiply. The context was in the context of marriage. And the man would leave his father and mother, cling to his wife, the two become one. And if you come together without the covenant of marriage. It's not a contract.
That's
without
right.
the covenant
right.
of That's marriage, right. then they're really, God can't be in the center of that. Mm-hmm. And if God isn't in the center of something, it's not going to go well.
You know, it goes back to honorable. What is honoring God? You know, when I dated my wife, I respected her so much that I didn't want to do anything that would bring down her reputation whatsoever. So, and again, I don't consider myself heads and shoulders above anybody else. To me, it's common sense. Mm. When you love somebody, you respect them, mm. and you want other people to respect them. So you abstain from the very, I don't know.
And I think we live in a generation that wants all of the benefits, but like you said, none of the commitment.
Right.
And the reality is that that's the misconception of this generation. And so like you, going back to what you said as well, is that people are trying to take God's original thing and switching it around, saying, well, we got a better idea and a better plan. And whenever we do that, mm-hmm. we're always going to find ourselves falling short.
You know, there's a scripture where God says in the book of Malachi, where's my honor?
Yeah.
Where is my honor? Of course, we know what that's leading up to. I'm just using that as a springboard. But where is God honored when we live by faith? Not by...
And it shows already that how selfish people are.
Yeah.
Because we're going into it already thinking about self.
Right.
Yeah. And marriage is one of the most selfless acts, I'm sure all of us can attest, right. that you'll ever step into. And so we're already going into it protected and guarded, saying, I got to worry about me. And so that's one of the reasons why I think probably that people are also setting themselves up for divorce.
You know, guys,
as well.
And I hear all of that, and I think, yeah, you're right. But my heart breaks for the young person, the millennial age person, who doesn't have any answers, and they're trying to find their answer. And they don't see it in their relationships with their parents. Their parents have more likely dissolved their marriage and gone on to another. And so they see that. So their logic, it makes sure. perfect sense to me.
Right.
I mean, my heart breaks for them because they don't have a stability of mm-hmm. what love really is. You know, how love can make a commitment and stick to that commitment.
Right.
How love can be in covenant and not just be in contract. And how it's not a legal thing, really. It's really a spiritual thing. And they love Jesus, but it's just convenient. And you guys are, I hope you're teaching your people this. Mm-hmm. A lot of pastors aren't teaching it.
That's right.
They're not hearing it. They're not hearing the truth.
One of the things that I would, you just said truth. And truth and love are two words we throw around in the church a lot, but often separate. We want to teach the truth, and then we want to go out and live in love. And living together sounds like a loving thing, but it's devoid of the truth. And Paul in Ephesians 4 told us when we're mature, what will happen? Mm-hmm. We'll speak the truth in love.
In love.
That's right.
And that's what if you have me on again, you'll hear me say this again, because I say it almost every week. Truth without love is easy. I mean, it's easy to preach the truth. If you don't care about people, you don't care about love. It's easy to love people. But if you put the two together, that's when it becomes a big challenge.
Discipline. That's mm-hmm. where the rubber meets the road.
Yeah.
We want to hear your hard question. Send it to us. hardquestions@ctvn.org, and you will hear the answer on this program with this panel another time. Hey, let's see what's going on with Amy.
You know, maybe you're going through something right now, and you're questioning what's in your heart. Am I right with God? Is what I'm doing right? You know, The same thing happened to David when the prophet Nathan came to him. After, listen to this, after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba, listen to what David said. He said, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Just blot out my transgressions. Wash away all of my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin." Are you saying that today? "Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow." David said this, "Create in me a pure heart, oh God." Are you carrying some things in your heart that you just don't feel right? And you're like, "I just need to get rid of this. I just want to be washed white as snow." All you have to do is pray this simple prayer. Say, "Father, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Be the Lord and the Savior of my life. Make me a brand new person. Wash me whiter than snow." And I'm telling you, in Jesus' name, when you pray that prayer, that cleanness is going to come over your heart in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer, will you give us a call at 888-665-4483 or email us and just let us know about your heart change. Listen, we're going to go to break, but coming up right after them is Cana's voice. Wait till you hear their harmonies and their voice and their anointed. We'll be right back.
Some say he is the Son of God. Others laugh and call him mad. Do you think he is who he says he is? Or just a carpenter gone bad?
Don't miss Hard Questions, where pastors come together to tackle the issues of the day right out of the Bible. This week, we take viewer questions. What do I say to my teen who wants to explore other faiths? And what does the Bible say about profanity? All that and more on Hard Questions, Thursdays at 10 a.m., 9 p.m., and Sundays at 4:30.
Want a way to share Bible verses, inspirational photos, or uplifting videos with your friends and family online? Like the Cornerstone Television page on Facebook. Every day, we'll keep you updated on show info, behind-the-scenes facts, and daily inspiration from our exclusive photos, videos, quotes, and more. Go to facebook.com/cornerstonetelevision to connect with us. We want to hear from you. Let's spread the good news of Jesus to our family and friends online.
Heavenly Father, you're the one we're waiting on. Because without you, there's no way that I can stay strong. I can't go on any longer on my own, so
hear me when I say,
Heavenly Father, we need your help today. Said I could, and I believe. You said if ever there was a time I needed you, I could get through. And if ever there was a time we needed you. Oh, Heavenly Father, you're the one we're waiting on. Because without you, there's no way that I can stay strong. I can't go on any longer.
time we needed you. Yes, if ever there was a time we needed you. You know it's every day, we need you in every way, every way. You know it's every day.
They sing in such harmony, and what a great united group they are. They are just so wonderful. And you know, we're going to talk now, too, about unity, and that we also need unity for God's kingdom. It's the key for us to thrive. And with so many different people and opinions, it can be a challenge. Our friend William Federer has a message from Miracle in American History about how all denominations came together to pray. Let's take a look.
Do you know this miracle in American history? On February 21st, 1786, New Hampshire's governor, John Langdon, set a day of fasting that he would be pleased to bless the great consul of the United States of America and direct their deliberations, that he would rain down righteousness upon the earth, revive religion, and spread abroad the knowledge of the true God, the Savior of man. Well, at the Constitutional Convention, where they were meeting in 1787, the 55 writers of the U.S. Constitution were 26 Episcopalian Christians, 11 Presbyterian Christians, 7 Congregationalist Christians, 2 Lutheran Christians, 2 Dutch Reformed Christians, 2 Methodist Christians, 2 Quaker Christians, 2 Roman Catholic Christians, and Dr. Ben Franklin, who called for prayer at the Constitutional Convention, saying, June 28, 1787, "In the beginning of the contest with Great Britain, when we were sensible of danger, we had daily prayer in this room for divine protection. Our prayers, sir, were heard, and they were graciously answered. All of us who were engaged in the struggle must have observed frequent instances of a superintending providence in our favor." Ben Franklin continued, "I have lived a long time, sir, and the longer I live, the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it probable that an empire can rise without his aid? We have been assured, sir, in the sacred writings that, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. I also believe that without his concurring aid, we shall succeed in this political building no better than the builders of Babel." Franklin ended, "I therefore beg leave to move that henceforth prayers imploring the assistance of heaven and its blessings on our deliberations be held in this assembly every morning before we proceed to business." U.S. Supreme Court Justice Hugo Lafayette Black wrote in Engle versus Vitale, 1962, "As late as the time of the Revolutionary War, there were established churches in at least 8 of the 13 former colonies and established religions in at least 4 of the other 5. Journal of Church and State, Volume 32, written in 1990, it said, "An establishment of religion in terms of direct tax aid to churches was the situation in 9 of the 13 colonies on the eve of the American Revolution." The Journal of the U.S. House recorded that on March 27, 1854, the 33rd Congress voted unanimously to print Representative James Meacham's report, which stated, "At the adoption of the Constitution, we believe every state, certainly 10 of the 13, provided as regularly for the support of the church as for the support of the government. Down to the Revolution, every colony did sustain religion in some form. It was deemed peculiarly proper that the religion of liberty should be upheld by a free people. Had the people during the Revolution had a suspicion of any attempt to war against Christianity, that revolution would have been strangled in its cradle." The same week Congress passed the Bill of Rights, President Washington declared October 3rd, 1789, whereas both houses of Congress have by their joint committee requested me to, quote, recommend a day of public thanksgiving and prayer to be observed by acknowledging with grateful hearts the many signal favors of Almighty God, especially by affording them the opportunity peaceably to establish a form of government for their safety and happiness, unquote. I do recommend the 26th day of November to be devoted by the people of the United States to the services of that great and glorious being who's the beneficent author of all the good that was, that is, or that will be. Washington continues, that we may then all unite in rendering unto him our sincere and humble thanks for the peaceable and rational manner in which we have been enabled to establish constitutions of government for our safety, happiness, and particularly the national one now lately instituted for the civil and religious liberty with which we are blessed. America has a unique history, and it's important for us to remember these miracles of American history.
Ladies, when I watch Bill's pieces, I always am inspired. They're always mm-hmm. full of information. Sometimes there's so much information you can kind of, it glaze over.
Right, right.
You know, mm-hmm. and the bottom line here for us and is that our nation, those men and women that founded this nation were coming from a different type of a world. They were coming from under the king. Yeah. The king of England ruled the world, really. Mm-hmm. Ruled Britain, ruled the world. And these colonists were nobodies. They were nobodies. No way could they stand up against the king of England.
Right.
Without what?
Divine providence.
Exactly right. Mm-hmm. And that's what Abraham Lincoln referred back to, and all of our history refers back to those moments of divine providence. But you can really take it even back to the beginnings when the Mayflower came mm-hmm. here yeah. from England and from Europe. God had his fingerprints all over this.
Right.
So whenever you look at our nation and you say, oh, that America is not a Christian nation, it wasn't founded by Christian people, how do you deal with that, Amy? What do you think?
Well, I mean, in order to see where we're at today and where we're going as a country, you have to look back at our history.
Right.
It's the very lens and the eyes to see where we're going. But like you said, they wanted to come out from under the kingship and come to a land where all of a sudden we're the kings in the land, and then there's public servants in office to help support us as the kings in our land. So I love it, a church founded by government and church, two of my favorite topics.
You're not supposed to talk about either one of those.
I know, it's politically incorrect. But
that's true.
Well, here in a parallel world, the colonists stood up to England and became free, a free mm-hmm. nation. Mm-hmm. In France, shortly thereafter, the French rebelled against their aristocrats, and they took over and killed all the kings, the king and the queen, and they created anarchy.
Yeah.
You see? And the difference between the two is God's freedom leads to liberty.
Yes.
And man's attempt at being free leads to anarchy.
Yeah, right. It was chaos too.
And Abraham Lincoln said something. I want to quote from the "In God We Trust" book for just a second. He said something. I think we're gonna keep this in mind. He said that America will never be destroyed from the outside. Mm. This is Lincoln. Lincoln speaking, would uh-huh. never be destroyed from the outside. If we falter and lose our freedoms, mm. it will be because we destroyed ourselves.
Mm. Wow.
That's was powerful. Him speaking in 1860s. What truth that is. Mm-hmm. And you know how close we are to marching
yes.
down this path of self-destruction,
mm-hmm.
all in the name of political correctness,
yeah.
that we are to the edge of this cliff
yeah. mm-hmm.
that we have to pull ourselves back from.
Yeah.
Thank God it's not too late.
Right.
It's never too late for God to make changes if we will repent and come to Him.
Well, and the important thing I got out of Bill's message is the importance of prayer.
Yeah.
I know we talk about it a lot, but look at prayer throughout. It was a thread throughout our country formation and how critical it is then and more so today. is the power of prayer.
Prayer, fasting. You hear me say it all again. Prayer, fasting, and sign the proclamation. If you have yet to sign the proclamation, go to ingodwetrust.tv. That's our place, our website. And on it, you're going to have the right privilege to sign this, virtually sign this proclamation. We're going to send it out to our governmental leaders. What's good is that going to do? It's going to say, here's a group of people who believe. There are other proclamations going. There are other petitions going. If we just bomb them with the truth, let's bomb them with the truth. Let's stand up. And then let's make sure that we go vote and we tell the people that we love to go vote and we help others to vote, then we can see God take over.
We have to come together in unity. Like all denominations, like you were saying, we're coming together for one purpose. And you know what? We are the United States of America. We don't have to be divided. If we'll come together, and like you say, if we'll pray, if we'll fast, if we'll vote and do our part, I believe God is going to move in our country.
Absolutely. A great revival is coming. Raise your hand. It's coming.
Amen.
Receive it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's go. Let's hear some good news.
I'm Sydney Grant for Good News 360. Here's the latest on how the Holy Spirit is moving in our nation and world. Christians ministering to Syrian refugees in Lebanon continue to spread the gospel despite mounting opposition. According to Christian Aid Mission, ministry workers are pushing through resistance from government officials and authorities. The organization reports missionaries are not only serving the Syrians in refugee camps, but they have also created prayer groups and are sharing the gospel in Lebanese communities. The election in America is less than 2 months away, and a new faith group is giving Christians a voice in the political process. Public Faith is a team of Christian leaders advocating for a perspective that challenges both political parties with a better vision. The group is calling on Christians who work in political parties to work together. Public Faith is not affiliated to any particular political ideology. And a Texas seminary is the first in the nation requiring students to complete training for awareness of sex abuse. Dallas Theological Seminary made the training mandatory for students starting this fall. The school is partnering with the group Ministry Safe. The seminary's president says they want students to be able to protect those who are the most vulnerable. That's all for Good News 360. Have a great day on purpose.
Now here's a question for you. What would you do if 60 people called you and said they wanted you to be their pastor? Think about that. That very thing happened to our next guest. Dr. Chris Marshall is pastor of New Life Christian Ministries in Saxonburg. Pastor, welcome to Real Life.
Thank you.
I'm so glad that you're part of it.
I know.
Terry being from the Saxonburg.
Went to Knock High School. My mom lives in Saxonburg, so I have this kinship with him.
Yeah, we worshiped in Knock High School and the elementary school for 9 years after we got started.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. Well, your story's amazing. You left. You wanted to share what
happened. Okay, I was a pastor for 17 years in the Presbyterian Church USA. Back in 2001, they made some decisions that I could not go along with theologically, so I had to leave the denomination, which unfortunately meant I had to leave the church I'd been serving for 11 years. And so I took off, and my plan was to go do carpentry work because I had those skills and eventually start a church in Cranberry Township because everybody was starting a church in Cranberry Township. But that week, about 60 people called and said, hey, you know, are you just going to leave? What are you going to do? Are you going to be our pastor or what? And so we had a prayer meeting the following week. But before that, two really amazing things happened. On Thursday morning, I went to visit a couple of friends of ours who had been in the former church, and their daughter was having surgery. And I showed up, and they said, "What are you doing here? You don't have to be here." And I said, "I don't have to do anything. I'm here because I love you, and your daughter needs prayer, and we're going to pray." And on the way home from that visit, I visited another guy to see if I could use his home for the prayer meeting on Sunday night. And he said no because his son was having a birthday party. But then he goes, "What's the plan?" And I said, "What plan?" And he said, "What are you going to do?" And I said, "I'm going to start a church in Cranberry down the road, but I'm going to do carpentry work." And he said, "Is that the only plan?" And I said, "Well, if God could provide the funds for my family to be supported, I'd start it right now." And he said, "I hope that was what you're going to say." And he went over, and he didn't know I was coming, and I didn't know I was stopping there. Mm. And he had an envelope with my name on it. Mm. And he handed it to me, and he put his hand on, prayed for me, prayed for, let's start this church. He goes, "Let's get started."
Wow.
So I drove up the road about a quarter of a mile, and I pulled over. I was curious, what's in the envelope, you know? And it was
$2,000. Wow.
And everybody sort of knows you can't start a church with $2,000 in America.
Okay.
But we went home. I went home, and I talked to my wife, my two daughters, who were 12 and 7 at the time, and we prayed about it. And we said, yeah, we're going to go ahead and do it. And so we started the following, the next day, this gets even better. The next day, a guy called me up and said, I heard you're not at Glade Run, which was the church where I was anymore. And he said, I said, no, I'm not. And he said, could you use a church? And I said, a building. He said, yeah, a church building. My grandfather has an empty church building. It's been empty for 2 years. And he said, I bet you if you would talk to him, he'd let you use it. So the next morning, I met this man, great man, Earl McRoberts, 89 years old, came walking into the church building with a cane, and he said, young man, I've been praying for God to send somebody to fill this place up again. And I said, you're going to have to send him to me. I can't even go looking for him. And I just about broke down, you know? I mean, tears came to my eye, and I said, Mr. McRoberts, I think I might be your man. And he said, if you support four missionaries, $25 a month, and pay the utilities, you can use the building as long as you want.
Awesome.
So the week after that, New Life Christian Ministries was born. We had 85 people our first week.
Man,
oh,
that's
my
fantastic.
Goodness.
Yeah, and then by the summer, we were in two services. It was a tiny building. And within 2 years, we had exceeded the 200 mark, you know, the 200 barrier they talk about.
Yeah.
And but at that point, we also had outgrown the building. We couldn't reach any more people. And our mission was to share the new life of Jesus Christ with the world, one person at a time. Pretty big mission. And we needed a bigger place. So one of our elders said, why don't we go to the high school to knock?
Yeah.
And so we talked to the school district, and they said they didn't know if that was legal, you know, because of the church-state thing. Mm-hmm. And we had done our homework, and we found out that every school district in Butler County had a church worshiping in it on the weekends, but knock.
Oh.
And so we told them that. And so they said, okay, we'll give you a one-month lease, and if it works out, we'll renew it. And I said, okay, you'll renew it for how long? For 1 month.
Oh, my goodness.
So we had a one-month lease for 6 years.
Wow.
And then they made it a three-month lease for 3 more years.
Oh,
and it was a great relationship. It really was. The Knox School District was wonderful to us. And during that period of time, actually, when we moved to the school district, we did something no church wants to do. We went from 225 people down to about 150. Over the next year or so, because people said, we have our church home, why do we have to go someplace else, you know? And but the mission was to reach lost people, not just to help, you know, collect people that already know the Lord.
Right.
And so we stayed the course, and we grew slowly, and then God provided a property, 20 acres, out in Saxonburg, and that was in 2005. And then finally in 2013, just 3 years ago, we built our first phase of a three-phase building process that we believe God's calling us to. And since 2013, we've gone from about 400 people up to about 750 right now.
Tremendous.
And so God's done cool stuff.
That is so cool.
Pastor, now, okay, that's quite the story.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I've ever heard a story quite like that.
I know.
What do you attribute that to? What is that? What's the reason behind that?
Well, the short answer is, you know, it was the right thing that God wanted to do, and I was obedient. I would say the big answer is that we had people from day one who were praying fervently.
Okay.
I mean, we had some prayer warriors at the outset of New Life. One gentleman who's gone home to be with the Lord, but an example is one day I had asked him if he would join me in a month time period where we would pray 3 hours and 20 minutes a day, for which would be 100 hours in a month. And he said, well, do you really want me to cut back in order to join you? In other words, he was already praying more than 3 hours and 20 minutes a day. So there was a lot of prayer undergirding it. In addition to that, there were a couple of pivotal points. The one pivotal point was when everything seemed to be going terribly badly as we moved into the school and stuff, enough people stayed with it to allow it to continue to go on. There were people with great faith who stepped forward and continued to provide, you know. And then in 2005, when we bought the property, that gave some impetus. But in 2008, we did several things. We hired a worship pastor who he has had such a unifying effect in the body. Sometimes we had a little problem between the sound people and the worship people. I don't know if any other church ever had that. But when Brad came on board, he just had this unifying, there was just more unity in the church. And unity is obviously God's, you know, point of blessing. You have to have unity to have blessing. And so that was a big step forward. Also, we got a strategy, I guess you would call it, and really went to a group called Harvest Time out in Colorado Springs, Colorado. Mm. And they gave us some direction of how we could be more intentional about doing what we knew God wanted us to do, developed a master plan for the property. And that gave us a step forward. But a tragedy actually is one of the major things that moved us forward. In 2011, we had a young girl from the congregation, very wonderful young girl. She was killed in a car accident. Her name was Alex Summers. At the time, we were worshiping about 250 people per weekend. The Sunday before she died on a Tuesday night. That Friday, we had her funeral, actually at the Saxonburg Presbyterian, because we didn't have a place big enough. 650 people came to the funeral.
Wow.
10 people got saved.
Oh.
Wow.
And the following week, we had 350 people.
Pastor, here's what I take away from this interview, and we would love to have you come back.
I know. Yes, we'd
please come
that.
Back. Is you stood up for the truth and left where you had to leave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Without any compromise, without any, well, conditional, you said, this is not what I believe.
Yes.
And you were willing to put it all aside and go back into doing what you could do with your own hands.
Mm-hmm.
And God didn't want to use your hands. He wanted to use you in your ministry call.
That's true for you.
I want to challenge you. If you're standing on the sidelines saying, what does God want to do with me? Here's the message for you. God isn't done with you.
Absolutely.
You don't have to set back and go, I'm useless to God. Maybe you were in ministry, now you're not. God has something for you. Maybe you want to be in ministry, you feel called, He has something for you. When we come back, we're going to have some time of prayer. So call the number that's on the screen and let's pray together. Let's stand together.
Absolutely.
God loves you. He has a plan for you. Let's go to break.
Hey, guess what's happening this weekend, Tom?
Well, it's National Cheeseburger Day.
And it's the block party. We're going to start with Bob Bennett in our living room concert.
And close the night with an amazing movie about a man of God named Albert Schweitzer.
That's this Saturday from 6 to 9 on the Cornerstone Block Party.
Do you feel lonely, forgotten, afraid? You are never alone. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Who is our God? Father to the fatherless, defender of widows. This is God whose dwelling is holy. God places the lonely in families. He sets the prisoners free and gives them joy. Know that your life has a purpose. You have meaning, and you aren't around by accident. I have called you back from the ends of the earth so you can serve me, for I have chosen you and will not throw you away. Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. If you ever feel alone, call our prayer lines. We are always here for you. Know that Jesus is with you wherever you are, and you are loved.
Just not sure which way is home. You're almost too tired to walk, and you're so worn out from being alone. But He's right there beside you, and He wants you to know He still cares. He still wants you for His own. His heart is big enough to love you, even though you've turned Him away. And His arms are long enough to save you and give you another chance to make up for your mistakes.
back to Him today.
Ladies and gentlemen, His heart is big enough. No matter how much pain you're feeling, no matter what you're going through, His heart is big enough. And Carol called in that lost a purse with everything in it. His heart is big enough. Molly called in, needs deliverance from physical ailments. His heart is big enough. And we've got tons of prayer requests here. Maggie is calling in, has a son in the Navy that wants peace and protection over him. His heart is big enough. And you know what? No matter what you're facing, no matter what you're going through right now, I want to encourage you that He cares. Jesus Christ cares for you. No matter how lonely you feel, no matter what you're experiencing in this very moment, He cares. It's not coincidence that you came by this television broadcast right now because His heart is big enough and He cares for you. We've got prayer partners here right now that are standing by that want to believe God with you for your breakthrough. That number is 888-665-4483. Call in right now. His arms are open wide. He's ready to be a blessing to you. He died on the cross to give you everything that you will ever need. And guess what? His heart is big enough for every circumstance and situation that you're facing right now. Go ahead and run to that phone. Even as they sang, run back to Him. 888-665-4483. God is ready to bless you. Don, it's back to you.
The word's very close to our hearts, and we focus on it every day on Real Life. And I want to take a minute to look at a word today that is a little bit hard. So let me just tell you, this is a hard word, but we need to look at things from the truth of the scripture. That's what was so enjoyed the interview with the pastor just now, because the truth is what sets us free. Not an illusion, but the truth sets us free. So let's read together. Matthew 24, verse 21, 22 says this: "For then there will be great tribulation such as not been seen since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. And unless those days are shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened." You know, that's a hard scripture. And it's talking about the tribulation period. And I don't focus on the negative, and I don't even think tribulation necessarily is negative. It's God's plan. And I want to make sure we all understand this is God's plan. And this is about when he's pressing mankind to understand his truth. Because God's a great teacher. He wants us to understand his truth. They will be difficult days, hard days, conditions that will continue. And if they did continue in those hard times, all flesh, the scripture says all flesh would die. But because of God's great love and his mercy and his kindness, those days are shortened. The hardship is shortened. But guys, if we don't talk about tribulation, if we don't talk about hell, then we're not telling people the whole truth. We're not going to tell the whole truth.
Right.
It's easier to talk about love and grace and the kindness of God and his mercy. And that's great. Those are all truths too. But if we don't talk about that there is a hell, a literal burning hell, and there will be a literal tribulation period, many people are going to be deceived.
And you can't appreciate a life preserver unless you know you're drowning. And so how can you appreciate and value the cross unless you know you're dead in your sins? So it's so important that we preach the whole gospel. You said the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Mm-hmm. So help us, God. And so we definitely have to have that whole, if we don't understand the bad news of what we're in, how can we appreciate the good news that we have in Jesus Christ?
That's right.
And Paul talked often in the New Testament about his trials and hardships and sufferings that he had to endure. And, you know, sometimes I hear people complaining and I just think, oh my gosh, go back and read what Paul went through,
right.
You know, and some of our Christian brothers and sisters that are in other countries right now where there's great persecution and tribulation and hardship. And I don't know, it makes my heart thankful for all that I have today, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, the period of tribulation, there are seasons of tribulation. There are seasons of testings.
Yep.
And James says to count them joy. When you get into that, count them joy. Because why? Because they create in us that maturity and perseverance.
Amen.
We become solid.
Yeah.
You know, without them, you can't be solid.
Right.
But then this is a period after the church is taken out of the picture, when there are 7 years of tribulation.
Yep.
3.5 years, the Bible says, are going to be peace and prosperity. And the Antichrist is going to come to that position. And this isn't theology time. I'm going to go into the great thing. But that's a reality.
Yep.
There is going to be an Antichrist.
Yep.
There is going to be an Antichrist. It's just not things of fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And he is going to rise to a worldwide position. There's going to be one world government.
Right.
You hear people whispering about that? That is coming.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And America's going to be part of it.
That's right.
America's going to be part of it because the Bible is true.
Mm-hmm.
Now the question is, what do we as the church do between now and the rapture? That's the truth.
That's what we're doing now, getting people ready.
That's the thing.
We want you to be saved before the tribulation happens. We want you to
be here.
Nobody want to be here during the tribulation.
We're not going to be here because it's God pouring out his wrath on sin.
That's right.
This isn't the devil turned loose. The devil's never turned loose. It's God pouring out his wrath on sin. So brother and sister, listen, if you know Jesus is your Savior, look up, the Bible says, for redemption draws nigh. He's coming soon.
Yes.
Coming soon. So let's be like those five wise virgins that were waiting for the groom. Keep your oil filled.
Yes. Amen.
Be in the Word. Be in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Walk in the power of the Holy Spirit.
And not to be fearful, but you need to be aware. I think you need to know what's going on, you know?
Yeah.
That's really important.
That's why we're talking about in God we trust so much. That's why we're talking about why Christians need to vote. We're not a political organization, but we're a spiritual organization. That's why that's such an important topic. And it's important for us to pray too. And Jay, do you have a prayer request?
I do. I have Jill here that's calling in requesting for a financial breakthrough from the
Amen.
Lord.
Amen.
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 And Hannah's calling. She is asking for spiritual increase. And I just think that's amazing. The Lord will increase you more and more, you and your children. So Lord bless her with spiritual increase. Amen. Open the eyes of her heart.
Amen. Oh, there's a lot here, but I would just like to pray for someone who is very low in potassium, and she's also borderline diabetic. That's sort of serious if you don't have potassium, yeah, isn't it? So we're just, Lord Jesus, heal her and build her up.
Mm-hmm. Eat a lot of bananas.
Yes.
Eat a lot of bananas. Tammy wants to be delivered from smoking. Tammy, I speak to you in the name of Jesus. Yeah. And that nicotine addiction needs to be broken. And I speak over your life right now in the name of Jesus that nicotine would be broken. And you'd be freed from the bondage of nicotine and any other bondage. That come. My sister just quit smoking. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. After 42 years of smoking. So.
It's
And she prays every day. She says, no, I don't want to pick up another cigarette. And that's what you got to do. You got to pray every day. Guys, thank you for your leadership.
Amen. Oh, yes.
Thank you for being part of this ministry.
Yes,
for
yours. Thank you.
Thank you for making a difference. So thank you, Terry. We on our anniversary.
Oh, that's
Yay.
Right.
Happy anniversary to you.
We don't have enough time to sing. Okay. We're so thankful for you guys as our partners. If you want to know how you can become a partner with us, there's ways that you can put your hand to the plow with us as we push through and make straight lines that God's planting seeds in and harvesting a new crop for eternity. That's what this program is dedicated for. It's new life. It's real life. It's God's life. It's the abundant life. And, you know, many times we have a tendency in life just to kind of sit back and watch. We're a spectator world. But we need to step up and act. Mm-hmm. Many of you who have ears to hear what I just said, you know what I'm talking about. Not everybody's going to listen, but you know what I'm talking about. And I want to encourage you to get involved. Join us in our work to take the gospel around the world. And this is how you can contact and be part of what we do and how you can connect with us. Watch this.
Habits. We've all got them. Good or bad, habits are a part of life. But how do you start something new that's good for you? Studies show that it takes 21 days to form a habit. That's like watching 504 hours of real life back to back. Here at Cornerstone, we want you to develop the habit of praying and fasting, which will help you be ready to vote this November. That's why, with your gift this month, we'll send you Don Black's book, In God We Trust, a 21-day action guide. Now, more than ever, starting these healthy habits will not just change your life, but will affect the nation. With daily instruction, scripture, and suggestions for further reading, this book is perfect to complete by yourself or with a small group. Do it for you, your family, and your nation. Call today with your gift to Cornerstone and you will receive this special book. Habits Take 21 Days. Start yours now.
Cornerstone Television wishes to thank all our faithful viewers whose consistent prayers and financial support have made this program possible.